What is the easiest way to install a PID in a Gallia Classic, and how the Z24 behaves in back-to-back shots? These are two questions that you made in my previous videos, and I'm going to answer today. And before you ask why adding a PID, I want to work with a wider range of temperature, lower temperatures that it's more difficult to achieve with precision when I'm surfing the temperature, because I need to flush some water through the group head. And then the temperature drop may be a bit high. It's much more convenient and doesn't make a big difference in my cup, but makes my life easier, especially in the early mornings. And if there's more stuff that you want me to cover, put your suggestions in the comments. Let's start with the bill of materials. I'm not gonna read all this, but you can take a print screen, and I'm gonna leave links in the description for all these components and tools. The scalable cutter and crimping tool is highly recommendable, but not mandatory, okay? You will be able to crimp your connectors with this part of a regular plier. Then you have to make your cables. I recommend you to buy the kit with multiple colors, because it's gonna make your life easier when you have to identify and connect the cables later. So the yellow and green I'm gonna use to command my SSR. Note that for the cables that connect the PID to the SSR, I have fork connectors on both ends. You don't necessarily need to use connectors, but it makes a cleaner installation. Those cables for the SSR in my case have 34 centimeters. Then you need two cables that will be connected to the SSR and to the terminals that were connected to your brew thermostat. This one doesn't have a connector on purpose, because I'm gonna show you how to crimp. But those cables should have a fork connector in one end and a male spade connector in the other end. And it should be also about 35 centimeters in length, which is circa 14 inches. We'll also need to power our PID. For that, we'll use piggyback connectors in one end, fork connectors in the other end. This cable here has about 39 centimeters. 15 inches. You need two, one of each color, red and black. This is a jumper for the steam thermostat, and I'm gonna explain later if you will need or not. It will depend on your choice if you want to keep the steam thermostat or not. It's a spade male on both ends, and it has 6 or 7 centimeters, about 2 or 3 inches. And now let me show you how to crimp your cable and why this tool is interesting. First, it has this cable cutter here. It works super nice. Clean cut. It's about 12 millimeters. Then you twist, put inside your connector. 12 millimeters was a bit too much, so maybe I can remove about 2 millimeters. And this way, I think it's nice. You need to see your wire, but it shouldn't be long. Then to crimp, I'm gonna put the connector between those yellow and blue marks. It's firm and I didn't damage the insulation. If you did the power mod, you will have here the connector green and red. There are the orange, and it's a bit difficult to see here, but this is the light blue. Then we are going to remove those two and connect the piggyback. The orange I'm connecting to the piggyback red. And this cable now will go to the switch. Now the light blue, again connecting to the piggyback. And the piggyback will go to the switch. These two cables will power the PID. And I'm going to pass through the ventilation hose. This is the steam thermostat. I label the connectors SA and SB. Now I'm gonna disconnect those two with my 17 millimeters range. If it is too tight, I can loosen it. Time to place the thermocouple type K under the thermostat, the steam thermostat. First, I'll pass through the ventilation hole. Then I'm gonna add some thermal compound to the thermostat. You don't need too much, it's just like a drop. And then it will be spread Thermocouple under the thermostat. Okay, it's hand tight only. Now I'll connect the two black wires to the number 1 and 2 in the SSR. Now I'm going to connect the yellow in the number 3. My convention is yellow in the positive, green in the negative. Green in the number 4 in the negative. So I use the screw to fix the SSR to the frame. It's an M4 by 12 millimeters with the respective nut on the back. I put the yellow and green upwards so that I can send it through the same ventilation hole that I'm sending all the other wires to the PID. Let's do that. Here you have the connectors for the brew thermostat that we're going to remove. It's a bit difficult to see, but we need to remove those two connectors here, okay? With a screwdriver, regular one, I can use the flat side to push a bit. Right, one is gone. Okay. So the easiest way was to use a screwdriver as a lever to pull the connectors. These are labeled as BA and BB, brew thermostat A and B. Now I'm connecting the two black cables that were connected to the SSR to BA and BB. Connectors to the steam thermostat. We have two options. We may attach to the steam thermostat. Then, when you're steaming, the temperature will be limited to 145 degrees. Or, if you prefer, you can put a jumper here and the maximum temperature will be limited by your PID. But remember that the PID will have an offset and you shouldn't go beyond 155. This is the maximum that they use in the Gadgeduino. I wouldn't go beyond that limit. And this means that 155 will be around 140 in the PID because of the offset. But the real temperature here will be 155. In my case, I'll keep the steam thermostat as an extra protection because I don't steam milk. So 145 will be more than enough for me. The cable for the thermocouple, we will not need all this length here. So I'm gonna keep a bit inside the machine. Same for the power cable, and organize my cable now with some zip ties. Okay, much better. Double face tape. This is a foam. It's easier to remove, but it's less resistant to the temperature. This is more resistant to temperature, but it's more difficult to remove. In my case, it's a temporary installation. I'm gonna use the foam one. It's about 2.5 centimeter, 1 inch in width. I'll clean the surfaces with isopropyl alcohol. You will need some space to be able to attach the connectors. Then the PID cannot be too much to the front, or you will not have space to attach the cables. Another important information is that you're gonna have a bare connector. And this is high voltage, so it's not advisable to leave it unprotected. I'm gonna leave it as is. It's my risk, it's temporary, but I would recommend you to buy a case for your PID and protect all the terminals. Press and hold for about 20 seconds. 1 and 2 is for power. We are connecting the black and red. 4 and 5 are for the SSR. 4 is positive, then it's the yellow. Green is negative. Now 9 and 10 are for the thermocouple. 9 is for the negative, 10 is for the positive. So blue in the 9, red in the 10. Now let's make a first test. I'm gonna use my power strip with a circuit breaker protection. Power. No short circuits. Seems to be working. Temperature is going up. Now let's see if the steam thermostat will stop heating in 145 Celsius degrees. Okay, so here the steam temperature was achieved, and then the thermostat is disengaging. So at 119 degrees, the temperature will go up again because the steam thermostat is activated. Yeah, the temperature went up to 144 and now it's going down. So the steam thermostat is working as a protection. Now that we know that everything is working properly, we will adjust the offset and check the temperature stability. But if you're leaving before that and the back-to-back tests, don't forget to give your like if you think that this content was helpful. To adjust the offset, you just press and hold set, and then you change until you see the SC, and then you can put the value that you measured with your thermometer. For this machine, Gadia Classic E24, it's -7. For other machines, I have a table in my webpage. Just go to espressohackers.com, and in those instructions, you will see a table with recommended settings for different PID models and different machines. When you press and hold, if you keep pressing the set, you will see the P, in my case, is 30, the I is 360, and the D is 8. And to adjust your desired temperature, you just press set and use the arrows to move between the digits and then increase or decrease. These are the basic settings. For more details, I'll leave a link in the description and a card here for my previous videos about the adjustments in the REC C100 and in the XMT. Let's turn off, close the machine. Remember to connect the ground wires. It's a bit tight for this cover with the SSR here. Just a warning here. Whenever you steam, remember to refill your boiler with fresh water to avoid damaging your heating element, okay? Now I'm gonna measure the temperature in back-to-back shots. So I'm gonna brew a shot, then I'll prepare another puck, and I'll brew the second shot. I'll measure the temperature stability and the initial and final temperature in those two shots to check if this machine can make coffees in sequence, or if we need to wait a bit until it preheats again for you to brew your second one. So the initial temperature is 94.4 Celsius degree or 202 Fahrenheit. The temperature is very stable in this extraction. We're not losing much temperature. So after 28 seconds, I got 41.8 grams, and the final temperature was 92.1 Celsius degree, 198 Fahrenheit. The variation was 2.3 Celsius degree or 4 Fahrenheit. Now between the shots, it took 4 minutes for me to prepare the second puck. The initial temperature now is 94.1 degrees, 201 Fahrenheit, very similar to the first one. And it took 23 seconds to brew 39.3 grams, a variation of 4.2 Celsius degree or 7 Fahrenheit. Okay, so the initial temperature was the same, I would say. It's 0.3 degrees difference between the first and the second shot. But the final temperature was lower in the second shot. It was 89.9 or 2 degrees lower than the first shot. So the temperature stability was a bit worse, but it's still, I don't think it's a significant difference that you will notice in your cup. Then in my opinion, you can do back-to-back shots. I don't know if you're super fast to prepare your puck, but in my case, I like to do my WDT. If you don't, maybe you're gonna be a bit faster. But then if you're faster than that, you can set a timer and start your extraction 4 minutes after the end of the previous one. And if you think that this video was helpful, don't forget to share with your coffee nerd friends and to hit your like and subscribe. Thanks for watching.